Morning. The first item of business is general questions. And at question number one, I call Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act 2018 has assisted the police in responding to reports of coercive control and stalking behaviours from members of the public.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, research on the operation of our groundbreaking legislation found that it better reflects how adult victims experience domestic abuse. Police Scotland are committed to supporting effective and consistent implementation. Staff and officers have had training and support to ensure they fully understand the legislation and how to best use it to protect victims and bring offenders to justice. Recent reports have highlighted that more is needed to make it easier for people to report domestic abuse and for perpetrators to be appropriately dealt with. And I am committed to working with partners across justice to consider how we best address this.
Fulton MacGregor.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that very positive response. In recent months, I've had contact from a constituent who reports continuing harassment from an ex-partner through the use of Ring doorbells, although not on her property. She further reports that the police dealing with her case seem unsure how to take forward such complaints regarding Ring doorbells, though are extremely sympathetic to the overall situation. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise if the current legislation on coercive control could include such behaviours that include the use of Ring doorbells, and if so, what further training may be necessary for frontline workers?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, domestic CCTV such as video doorbells is covered by data protection legislation, which of course is a matter reserved to the UK Government and nonetheless is regulated by the Information Commissioner's Office. If an individual believes that domestic CCTV is being used in a way that is antisocial, harassing or intimidating, that this may be a criminal matter and they can of course contact the police. There is of course more work to be done, which I'm committed to exploring in and around the use of data. But there is a very clear message that despite the strategic shift in policing to prioritise and understand and to tackle domestic abuse with lots of examples of good practice, we know from all the most recent research that improvements could be made across the justice sector on how cases are handled, and we need to be given victims maximum assurance that their voice is heard and that proceedings and support throughout the process is more available.
Pam Gossel.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Parties across this chamber agreed with the 2018 Act. However, for the Act to be truly effective, the police need more resources. As it stands, frontline officers don't have the support they need from the government to fully enforce it fully the new law. So given the rise in domestic abuse cases since the Act was brought in, does the Cabinet Secretary accept that the police need more resources to deal with more domestic abuse crimes?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, in terms of the most recent domestic abuse crime stats, while there has actually been a decrease of 1% from the previous years, I would of course agree with the member that these figures are a stark reminder about the gendered and hidden nature of domestic abuse and that we need to be committed to tackle the systemic issue in our society, both today, tomorrow and for the long run. In terms of issues about resources for police, the policing investment is £1.45 billion for this financial year. That is an additional £80 million, an increase of 6.3%, and right across the justice sector we are investing £3.4 billion, again an increase of £165 million, and that investment is being put to good use to deliver justice for women.
Question number two, Michael Mara.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it plans to review its approach to drafting financial memoranda in light of concerns raised by the Finance and Public Administration Committee.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robison.
The Scottish Government endeavours to provide its best estimates of anticipated costs and or savings in the financial memoranda which accompany bills in line with the requirements of standing orders. The Scottish Government is also committed to responding to any issues identified by Parliament in its scrutiny of bills and their accompanying documents.
Michael Mara.
Last week, the Deputy First Minister admitted that her government had managed the public's money so poorly there's a looming £1.9 billion black hole in the public finances. Is that any wonder when their approach to drafting financial memoranda is so woefully inadequate? The committee in question has raised serious concerns about the financial memoranda for two significant pieces of legislation, the National Care Service Bill and the Children Care and Justice Bill. Can I ask the government why, ask the Minister why the government doesn't think it necessary to publish a revised financial memorandum for either bill before the conclusion of stage one?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, on Michael Mara's comments on the MTFS statement last week, of course, if he'd been listening to what I said in the statement, he would have heard, and this is, of course, confirmed by the Fiscal Commission, that the key reasons for the challenge in next year's budget in particular are firstly due to UK government cuts to both resource and capital budgets to this Parliament. And Michael Mara should know, of course, that makes up the bulk of the money that this Parliament and this government has to spend. Secondly, of course, inflation and the impact that that has on our budget and, of course, the impact that has on the pay deals that go beyond what was budgeted for in last year's budget. So Michael Mara should stick to the facts about what is lying behind the statement I had to make last week. In terms of the issues on the financial memoranda, in terms of the Children's Care and Justice Bill response, we of course welcome the feedback of the Finance Committee and the views coming forward at stage one. The issue is really that the matters have developed in terms of the financial memorandum. Inflation has increased. And, of course, the Scottish Government could not have forecast, which, of course, the committee itself acknowledges that the government could not have forecast the inflation increase. So the stage one process has brought additional detail and helpful information, and that is, of course, part of the bill process. There will be an update to the financial memorandum based on stage one and based on the updated information from partners that are involved in the implementation group. And that work will take place and will update the financial memorandum following and reflecting stage one. And on the National Care Service, the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport has agreed to provide an updated financial memorandum as well as a response to the recommendations of the report 4 weeks before the stage one debate. And of course, that will take account of any agreements and decisions reached over the summer.
Question number three, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government when it plans to publish the review by Zero Waste Scotland into the environmental impact of single-use vapes.
Minister Lorna Slater.
The Scottish Government recognises the significant concerns around the environmental impacts of single-use vapes alongside the prevalence of young people vaping in Scottish society. On the environmental impacts, Zero Waste Scotland submitted the initial findings of their report on the impact of single-use vapes at the end of May. The findings are currently being considered and the report is undergoing final revisions prior to publication, which we expect to take place in June. I look forward to the report's findings being published and the opportunity to discuss potential next steps to address this issue.
Stuart McMillan.
I thank the Minister for that reply. And as Minister will be aware, the BBC recently reported where they took 18 vape products found in a school in England, almost all of which were not legally registered or tested, and sent them for independent testing which showed they contained highly toxic chemicals, such as crotonaldehyde, in concentrations well above the recognised safe exposure levels, in addition to containing heavy metals such as lead, chromium and cadmium. I can ask the Minister what work is being done across government to tackle the damage that these devices are doing, not only to the environment, but also to our young people's health.
Minister.
I am deeply concerned about recent reports of illicit vapes containing high levels of lead, nickel and chromium. UK-wide regulations are in place to ensure minimum standards for the safety and quality of e-cigarettes. Through the Society of Chief Officers of Trading Standards in Scotland, we continue to support strong national and local alliances to tackle the availability and sale to under-18s of illicit tobacco and vapes. Any action we seek to take will build on the regulations already in place to restrict the marketing, promotion and sale of vaping products to under-18s.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I received representations from a young person in Shetland with concerns about the impacts on health, the environment and peer pressure from vaping. Flavours such as bubblegum and candy floss and bright rainbow packaging on shop counters are not there to catch the eye of adults. I spoke with my constituent this morning. They want to see the sale of vapes removed from shop counters. Will the Scottish Government review regulations on vape sales, packaging and advertising?
Minister.
The report from Zero Waste Scotland will look at a range of available policy options, including a potential ban on single-use vapes. I am fully aware of the strength of feeling on this matter and particularly concerns around young people's use of vapes. There have been powerful campaigns for a ban undertaken by Less Waste Laura and the Daily Record and others. So this review will consider various options, for example, increasing access to responsible disposal options and improved product design. So I look forward to that review coming out and we'll discuss next steps from there.
Question number four, Craig Hoy. Thank you, Mr. Hoy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Apologies about that. To ask the Scottish Government what additional support it plans to provide to tourism, hospitality and leisure operators in the south of Scotland region.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
The Scottish Government recognises that the tourism, hospitality and leisure sectors are a crucially important part of the south of Scotland economy, and these sectors create jobs, sustain communities and contribute significantly to the well-being of the southern Scotland economy, and often forming the cornerstone of the local economy as well, and enabling visitors and residents alike to experience the incredible offers we have across the whole region. And we are supporting the South of Scotland Destination Alliance with a £2.7 million five-year funding package. That's an industry-led leadership group driving the region's tourism, marketing and destination development. We are also working with a diverse range of businesses throughout the region, from large projects such as a £2.6 million investment in the £18 million sustainable development in the Tweed Valley and Forest Holiday Cabins at Glen Tress Forest. And we're also working with different accommodation and attractions in the region, from glamping to museums and visitor facilities.
Craig Hoy.
I thank the Minister for that answer, but all that he's said overlooks the fact that he is well aware that many operators face far higher business rates as a result of his government's failure to pass on 75% rates relief that is being made available in England. Yeah. Pubs and cafes also face enormous pressures, including the shambolic deposit return scheme, while tourism operators face the burden of the SNP's short-term lets regulations. Yeah. So isn't it the case that the SNP not only lacks a dedicated Minister for Tourism, it also lacks any credible policy to support this vitally important sector in the south of Scotland?
Minister.
As the Minister with responsibility for tourism and hospitality, can I just say how much I enjoyed my recent visit to Glen Tress to meet the company that are investing millions of pounds into that region, and it's great to see that the product that's been developed in his region is attracting so much investment and will attract visitors from around the world to visit. Can I also say that whilst we do recognise there's a role for the Scottish Government to play in a subgroup of the new business deal, we'll look at business rates and other issues. The issues I find that tourism businesses in the south of Scotland and elsewhere raise with me are high energy costs, the need to cut VAT, the impact of high inflation, the impact of Brexit on labour shortages, all of which are the responsibility of the Members' Party in the UK Government, the Conservative Party. So likewise, he may wish to make strong representations to them.
Emma Harper.
The Minister mentioned energy costs and the impact of the energy crisis on hospitality, on pubs and bars and restaurants, including across the South Scotland, has been substantial, with trade bodies recently revealing an average of bills that have surged by 81% over the past year. Can the Minister provide any update regarding the Scottish Government's latest engagement with the UK Government regarding the support that can be provided to businesses experiencing the pressures with energy costs? And does he anticipate that further support will be forthcoming?
We must have brief questions and responses, Minister.
Well, thanks. And we certainly share the industry's concerns that Emma Harper raises about the impact of rising overheads, such as energy costs. We have extended energy advice to businesses by investing £300,000 to expand the services of Business Energy Scotland, whilst also doubling the value of the SME Energy Efficiency Loan and Cashback Scheme for energy efficiency to £20,000. We've also established a task force with COSLA to support businesses, because we know there's much more that needs to be done. But the Minister for Energy, in terms of rising energy costs, is due to meet the UK Minister for Energy Consumers next week, and will be raising this very important issue with her at that time, and will continue to make strong representations to the UK Government to address high energy costs.
Question number five, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what options it foresees for the future of Ferguson Marine after ferries 801 and 802 are built?
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gregg.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We know that Ferguson Marine is actively pursuing many streams of future work, such as the recently announced contract with BAE to support the Type 26 frigate programme, and we are committed to securing a sustainable future for the shipyard.
Graham Simpson.
Well, I would thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but it wasn't an answer because it didn't answer the question, which was what options he sees for the future. I don't know what options he foresees for the future. But if he wants to return the yard to the private sector, as he says he does, then investment's going to be needed. So has he done an assessment of how much investment? The Scottish Government has commissioned an independent review into funding and future options for the yard. When are we going to see that?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I thank Graham Simpson for his question. Ferguson Marine has provided the Scottish Government with a formal request for capital investment as part of its plan to make the shipyard more competitive, and this request is currently being evaluated. Any request for funding will of course be subject to subsidy control impacts and other assessments that are required, and Parliament would of course be updated in due course. But I'm sure in terms of asking about the publication of the document that he refers to, I'm sure Graham Simpson would not want to make the yard uncompetitive by releasing commercially sensitive information that is contained within it. Of course, we're looking at the detail that we can publish, and that work is ongoing.
Katie Clark.
Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that it's the Scottish Government's responsibility to clear up this mess? It's not the fault of the excellent workforce at Ferguson Marine, or indeed the people of Inverclyde. And will he provide a timescale on potential future ferry contracts after 801 and 802?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. Of course I pay tribute to the workforce who have been, as I've done in all the times that I have either appeared before committee or in this chamber, for the outstanding work that they are doing in incredibly difficult circumstances. We have taken decisions about ensuring that 801 and 802 can continue to be progressed and completed at the yard, and will continue to support the yard to secure future work as best we can going forward.
Question number six, Paul O'Kane.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on phase three of the Lenning Estate investment programme, including in relation to the planned date for the announcement of successful projects.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
Presiding Officer, I know that local authorities are keen to get clarity on phase three of the Learning Estate investment programme. I recently visited Perth High School and the Dunfermline Learning Campus projects, and I very much recognise the difference sleep projects will make to local areas. Scottish Government officials wrote to all local authorities in March to explain that consideration about the projects that would form part of Phase 3 was still ongoing. This set out that further time was necessary to consider the scope of Phase 3, including to take account of the impact of market volatility on current projects. However, I'm committed to announcing the successful Phase 3 projects before the end of this parliamentary session.
Paul King.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. It's clear that Parliament needs to see details of this now overdue phase three of the Learning Estate Investment Programme, because currently there are too many schools across Scotland which are in desperate need of upgrading. As the Cabinet Secretary will be aware, in my region it's been estimated that it could cost up to £160 million to rectify Renfrewshire Council's monumental error in the calculation of the school roll for the new Dargavel Primary School in Bishopton. Indeed, the First Minister, in answer to my colleague Neil Bibby, said that the Cabinet Secretary would enter discussions with Renfrewshire Council to try and resolve this situation, and indeed to try and avoid any detriment to the learning resource available to Renfrewshire Council. So can she confirm if these discussions have taken place, and can she assure the Chamber that there will be no detriment to the Learning Estate Investment Fund allocations to Renfrewshire in order to resolve the error, given the need for new schools across the authority?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr O'Kane for his question. He may not be aware that this issue was raised by his colleague in the Chamber yesterday during the debate that we held on the national discussion. I committed to Neil Bibby yesterday to meet with him and to meet with the parents as well involved in the school that he has outlined. I know that officials are already engaging with the local authority, and I intend to do so imminently. In relation to investment coming from this Government, I would just like to put on the record, Presiding Officer, that since, of course, the SNP came to power, we have significantly invested in our school estate. When the SNP first came to power back in 2007, only 61% of our schools were in good or satisfactory condition. Today, that's over 90%. Now, that's real progress under this Government. There's more, undoubtedly, that we will need to do, and I look forward to working with the Member to that end to drive the improvements we need to see across our school estate.
That concludes general questions. The next item of business is First Minister's questions.